Let me start with the most basic question. We hear about a lot about generative AI,
yes,
and ChatGPT and various chatbots. Is this a difference in kind or in degree compared to what we've already had, frankly, with machine learning?
I think it's a difference in a little bit of both. You know, I mean, it's a different in kind in terms of the quality of output that we're getting. You know, our perception of what the AI is generating has suddenly crossed a threshold to being really human-like. And so from that point of view, from a user experience point of view, it's definitely a difference in kind. If you look under the hood of the AI, it's just been incremental improvement from old technologies. We've had these kinds of generative AI systems for a really long time. They haven't been performing very well. There've been a couple of new technologies. I think the drug discovery industry helped us progress a lot in generating these molecule combinations or these protein combinations that might lead to successful drugs. But over there, it's been more of a difference in degree. But you know, as you cross a certain level of improvement with the same technology, then people suddenly start to see it as a difference in kind.
Whatever it is, ChatGPT has certainly got everyone talking about this, and there's,
yeah,
a lot of speculation about it really replacing humans in various fashions. You know this area well. As you look at it, where are the areas, as you look around the business world, the economy, that are most likely to be disrupted by this new generative AI, and which are the ones that probably won't be so much?
Well, the industries where I expect that generative AI and technologies that are built on GPT-4 and Llama and, you know, sort of Google's technology, the things that are able to be human-like in their interactions and have this massive knowledge base, I'm certainly paying very close attention to healthcare, because although healthcare has made tremendous strides in the last 200 years, I mean, there was no healthcare industry 200 years ago, now it's a double-digit percentage of GDP, we're still scratching the surface in terms of fulfilling human need. And as a consequence, I think that there are vast swaths of the population who don't have access to the healthcare when they need it. And so instead of relying exclusively on a human being to deliver that healthcare, there'll be a whole range of technologies based on generative AI that will help you fulfill your healthcare needs. Financial advice is another area where I expect that, like, you know, the population that can gain access to frequent financial advice will expand dramatically. But I think the real opportunity isn't in consumer-facing stuff, it's in business-to-business. Because for the last 25 years, we've been trying to create good knowledge management systems in organizations. You know, during the early days of the internet, there was a lot of excitement about these intranets that would, you know, organize your company's information. And they made it searchable, but they didn't make it accessible in a way that helps in decision making. I think what the generative AI is going to do is going to allow you to take the knowledge that is contained in documents, that is contained in email, that is contained in contracts, and create a sort of a digital twin, in a sense, of key employees, so that you are able to access their knowledge more readily. If they go on vacation and you want to ask them a question, you can ask their digital twin a question. So knowledge management is where I think there's a tremendous amount of potential.
Let's pursue that knowledge management in a moment. As you look forward, assuming a success in really taking over knowledge management for a lot of large organizations, is that likely to be proprietary to the individual company involved, or is it likely to be off the shelf? Is there going to be some provider of knowledge management that everyone will be buying, or does each corporation need to develop its own?
I think it's going to be a combination. You're going to need a technological expert that can take the documents and the knowledge in your organization, sort of meld it with the GPT-4 or whatever large language model technology, retrain the model so that it can answer questions that are relevant to you. And that's going to be proprietary to you. So the system that's built will be proprietary to you. But there probably will be a few large-scale experts who are able to access, for example, the successor of GPT-4 and retrain it to sort of customize it to your company. And so there will be some concentration, but the eventual system that is built will be proprietary to your organization.
When you mentioned healthcare and financial advisory services, those are two particular areas where you need to get it right. I mean, truth
Absolutely,
and falsity
yeah.
really matters. A lot of the reports, early reports, out of some of the ChatGPT and other similar generative AI, suggest it doesn't really have a check against truth, what is actually true out there.
These early systems have not been trained with accuracy as a key objective. What they're really trying to do is to be as human-like as possible, be able to, you know, write a poem in the style of Shakespeare. So it's really sort of the interactivity and the style that has dominated over the accuracy. I mean, they don't even have access to a calculator, for example, and so we've often seen them make math mistakes. I think that's a problem that, as you focus the domain of expertise, is easily fixable. All you need to do is retrain the system with a new set of documents and make accuracy one of the key objectives. So it's like you've trained the system to know grammar and to have vast general knowledge, and now you're layering on top of that some expertise in a particular area. You're giving it an advanced degree, so to speak. So the accuracy problem will go away after a point as you focus the domain.
Professor, as you look at the potential for generative AI, can you choose between, on the one hand, the large organizations that are already very active in it? You mentioned Google, for example. There are others that are really very active in this, as opposed to some of the VCs and the startups and the entrepreneurs. I mean, is this something that is being taken over by the big guys, or is there a lot of room for investment in some of the small startups?
So some of the big guys, Facebook, Google, Microsoft, through OpenAI, have made massive investments in building the infrastructure, the large language models, the things that, you know, systems like ChatGPT are built on. And so it's certainly going to consolidate some of their tech power. But it's important to remember that these are platforms. These are systems that other companies can tap into. And all of these companies have a platform mindset, which is that they realize that if they open up their system for other people to build on, it increases the entire value of the ecosystem. I mean, Microsoft realized this early on when they were selling us MS-DOS and Windows. And so it's in the DNA of these companies to be inclusive, but some of that value will flow to the companies. And so will it increase or reduce inequality across the economy? That's a really hard question to answer. I think it'll depend on the country, it'll depend on the social and political system wrapped around things. But I think a little bit of both again.
Talk about the political or the regulatory system and how it may intersect with what we're seeing in artificial intelligence. What are the issues for the government and the governments in figuring out how to regulate this?
I think one of the things that we're going to hit up against immediately is Section 230. This is the section of regulation that shields platforms from liability for the content that they deliver. They're not publishers, they're intermediaries. Once you start to create a system like ChatGPT, it raises the question of, you know, if you are in fact delivering a single piece of content as an answer through an interface, are you a publisher or are you an intermediary?